Everyone, and welcome back to the next episode of Tilly. I'm your host, Marissa Zeppieri-Caruana. A lot of you already know me as Lupus Chick. If this is your first time here, Tilly is brought to you by the Lupus Foundation of New England. Every Tuesday night at 8 o'clock Eastern, we bring in some guest that has to do with lupus or chronic illness. You can go back into our video library. We have over 60 episodes. And today I am so excited because I have been wanting to get this guest on for quite some time. She's hilarious. Ayana Dupuy, some of you may already know her from Instagram. She's an incredible lupus advocate, and she is also a comedian. So Ayana, thank you so much for being here. And I would love for you to introduce yourself to anyone who hasn't met you yet.
All right, thank you so much for having me. Like you said, my name is Ayana Dupuy. I'm a stand-up comedian and a writer based in Brooklyn, New York. I'm also a lupus advocate. I host a bi-monthly podcast called Hydroxychloroquines with my co-host, Chanel Gabriel. She's a poet and a singer. And the purpose of the podcast was to just talk about our life, our journey living with lupus, and to just make it more accessible to other warriors that are just dealing with the basic day-to-day things that we deal with having lupus, you know, whether it be just having a day job, whether it be pursuing your dreams, whether it be relationships, whether it be dating, just those kinds of things. So that's me.
There's so many things I often tell people, like, I liken lupus to water because it will literally seep into every single area of your life, right? Yes. That it can go into. And I remember the first time I saw your hydroxychloroquines and I cracked up and I thought, was this sort of something that came out of COVID? Like, was this produced during COVID?
No, it was after COVID. I missed the whole COVID wave. I was too busy baking bread and being anxious. That was what I did. I regret that because it seems like so many opportunities were birthed during COVID and I did not take advantage of any of it. But it is what it is. No, it was birthed afterwards. My husband jokingly called me hydroxychloroquine one day, just I don't know why. And it made me laugh. And I thought, I was like, that's a good name for a podcast. And initially I was going to do it by myself, but then I was like, I don't know if, I mean, I'm sure I can talk to myself for 15 to 20 minutes.
Yeah.
But I thought it would be a lot more fun to have another lupus warrior with me. And I was trying to figure out like, who could I get? And I had just had fibroid surgery and I was on Instagram complaining that my pharmacy was closed unexpectedly and I couldn't get my oxy. Post-surgery, just make sure you understand it was post-surgery that I was trying to get oxy, not just randomly trying to get oxy. So Chanel hit me up. As we just started talking, I was like, hey, do you want to do a podcast? And she was like, yeah, that sounds great. And I was like, all right. And then 2 weeks later, we were recording the first episode. And so now initially, I wanted it to be a weekly podcast, but I just remembered that I have lupus and other things to do, and managing a weekly podcast just became too much. And I feel like the folks who are listening to the podcast who also have lupus can understand, like, we will take it twice a month.
And absolutely.
Yeah. So that's how the podcast came about. And like I said, we just try to just talk about, I don't know if the way normalizing lupus, I guess that's a way of putting it. But like you said, I like that analogy. It seeps into everything that we do. So always remind Chanel, like, we don't got to get too on the nose when it comes to lupus. I'm sure once we start talking about anything, lupus is going to find its way into the conversation because we're warriors. It always does. Yeah.
Yeah. And even, I think even for people like our healthy peers, trying to do something once a week, like a podcast or a video cast or whatnot, like, it's a lot. So then you throw in chronic illness and work and your spouse and all the other fun things that life brings us. And it's overwhelming.
Very much so. Very much so. And it's, you know, when I became a comic, obviously, I think maybe MySpace existed. I'm really dating myself, but there was not much social media. Yeah. And now I feel like it can become very exhausting and very overwhelming trying to keep up. especially if you're trying to push something, if you're trying to get seen, it's just a constant go, 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 go. And just the way the algorithm works, it's like you have to post every day. And that's a lot. That's intense.
It is a lot. So, well, your comic, that's how I found you and just fell in love with you on Instagram. And I was like, okay, we have to have her on. And I want to get into that because there's a couple of questions about that I absolutely have for you. But I want to go back a little bit. If you can share maybe what are the first like symptoms that you remember having and how old were you? And like, what was that journey like till you actually got an answer of what was wrong?
So my first symptoms, I initially thought I was having symptoms in my hands, and I went to college for engineering and math. So that was my profession. I would be in front of a computer all day. And for 2 years prior to being officially diagnosed, I just thought I had carpal tunnel, you know, just constantly on a computer, constantly typing. I'm bound to have it, right? And just because I was having a lot of joint pain in my hand, but it wasn't anything that was keeping me up. It wasn't anything that was really giving me pause. It was more of an annoyance, a nuisance, than I must get this looked at right now. So that happened for 2 years. And what's funny is a few weeks ago, I had a Facebook memory pop up when I did this this event called 48 Hour Film Festival, where you have 48 hours to make a short film. And some pictures popped up from when I did this probably the year before I was diagnosed with lupus. I was diagnosed November 2012. So probably from 2011. These pictures popped up and I realized I had a hand brace on. And it just threw me back into the memories of thinking, oh, I have carpal tunnel. Let me just go to CVS and grab a hand brace so I can give my hand some support. Not realizing that that's not what it was. And it's just so ironic, just so, I don't know the feeling. I don't know the word to describe the feeling I have when I look back at those pictures, not realizing that something I thought was so minor was going to be such a major player in my life down the road. So what actually got me to going to the doctor and realizing this is a problem, this is something I need to really look at. It's not just carpal tunnel, which I initially was diagnosed with tendonitis, not carpal tunnel. I was given a cortisone cream, that didn't work. I eventually got a cortisone shot in my wrist, that worked for a few months, and then back up with the pain. So it got me to the doctor. One morning I woke up and my hands were stuck like crabs. That's what I always say, claws. And like just stuck like this, and to the point where I had to do that to open my bedroom door. And yeah, I was like, well, that's weird. But again,
it's not normal.
Yeah, this is weird. But I wasn't sick. I never had illness. I'd never even heard of lupus. I had never even heard of the term autoimmune condition. Like none of these things were part of my universe. I knew my dad has gout. I knew gout ran on that side of the family. So I'd hear about gout, but I didn't even know that was an autoimmune condition. So again, I was just like, oh, I must have slept weird. I must have slept curled up, or, you know, we always find ways to make excuses. To just make sense to ourselves. So I went in the shower, hot water, hands loosened up, went about my life. Next morning, we're back in the crabs. And now I'm like, okay, this is weird. So I called my father and I was like, hey, do I have gout? All right, because that's all I know. That's all, you know, I'm aware of. And he said, yeah, that does not sound like gout, but it also sounds like you need to go to the doctor. And my father's Caribbean, and to get a Caribbean man to go to the doctor or even recommend a doctor, that's a lot. So I was like, ooh, if you are immediately jumping to doctor, then I think I should go to the doctor. So I went to the doctor. Apparently I was running a fever, didn't know it. He asked me, he's like, how are you feeling? And I was like, I'm fine. Are you tired? I'm always tired. I have three jobs. I'm a comic, I'm an engineer. And at that point I was a Weight Watchers leader. I'd lost 65 pounds of Weight Watchers and I was leading meetings, probably about 7 meetings a week. So I have three jobs, I should be tired. So he does blood work, which I'm very confused because I'm like, hey, why are you doing blood work? My hands are like this, treat my hands. And blood work comes back like a day later, showing markers for an autoimmune condition. And I knew that just because my sister was a nurse in school and one of my sorority sisters was a nurse. And I sent it to them and they're like, oh, this looks like an autoimmune condition. And I was like, don't know what that is. Did not even know if it was serious, nothing. He does more blood work at this point while I'm waiting for, he gave me a steroid pack. I remember that because I was going on vacation to Jamaica. And I remember going to Jamaica and being in bed by 8 o'clock every night. And again, I have three jobs. This is the first time I've had a chance to relax. Should be tired. Came back November 9th, 2012. It was 3 days after my 31st birthday. I got an email from that doctor, my general practitioner, and he said, this is lupus. I can't treat you. Here's your referral for a rheumatologist. And I remember I was at work. I got up from my desk after reading that email. I went to the bathroom and I started to cry. And honestly, the reason I was crying is because I already knew that I was planning on quitting that engineering job and moving to New York within the next 6 months to pursue my comedy career. And the last thing you need or want when you're about to quit your very stable, very lucrative engineering job to go live as an artist in one of the most expensive cities in the world is a chronic illness. That's my lupus story. Well, wow. The beginning of it. Yeah.
Thank you for sharing that. I mean, yeah, that's intense. And I think, you know, like you obviously had a lot of schooling and you became an engineer and it's, you know, so I think people feel like, well, she's well-educated and, you know, blah, blah, blah. Like you should have heard of, how did you not know what lupus is? And I think people don't realize like, you don't hear or know about a lot of chronic illnesses unless you or someone very close to you is diagnosed with it, right? Mm-hmm. Like you might hear it in passing and it just doesn't stay stored in your memory because it's not something that's impacting your life every single day.
I say that lupus is, I still try to write jokes about it, but one of my first jokes was about having a C-list disease. It's not a celebrity disease. It's not, and I'm not trying to minimize anybody who actually, you know, who has other conditions, but it's not cancer. It's not sexy like breast cancer. We have our walk, but you know, M&Ms aren't throwing us on a bag, you know, the NFL, they're not wearing purple. You know, I don't know if they are, maybe they are now, but all the prestige is not the word I'm looking for. All the attention that like, breast cancer, you know, even if you don't know somebody with breast cancer, you know, Susan G. Komen, you know, the pink ribbon, you know, all of these things. And lupus just doesn't have that same pizzazz.
Right.
Yeah.
And I think honestly, you know, I've been diagnosed now for 20 years. It's only in the last 10 years, I can really say like through social media and just media in general, I think, you know, a lot of more people see it or at least hear about it today than even just a decade ago, right? But we're still not like where we need to be. Well, first I have to commend you because one, losing that weight is no easy task, especially when, you know, you obviously had something probably brewing in your body and didn't even know it. And two, I think just with or without having a chronic illness, I think quitting a career like that and moving to New York City, my hometown, by the way. And that's a very scary thing just in its own, you know? So I think it really speaks to the kind of person you are. And I love that story. I don't like the lupus part of it, but I love the rest of that story. And obviously for comedy, I mean, that's how I found you online. And I was just going through your videos and I was cracking up and I was like, this is amazing. Like someone's finally talking about this in like, a public setting on a regular basis and joking around about all of the craziness that comes with lupus, right? So what is that like to be able to use your own life for your jokes and, you know, for your skits, and how do people typically react to it?
So first of all, thank you, but also gained that 65 pounds back. Thank you, COVID. Not all of it, but you know, I was baking a lot of bread. So we are trying to get that weight off. I'm actively working on it, so I'm not too stressed out about it. But you know, the thing is, people still don't know what lupus is, and I think that's one of the biggest challenges when it comes to me writing a joke, because I'll say it, and you can feel the blank stares and not understanding what it is. And even if they know or they've heard what it is, they don't know what it does. This drives me crazy when people tell me feel better, and I know they mean well, but it's like, I'm not gonna feel better. This is it. This is my life. It's
yeah. A chronic get well illness. Soon.
Yeah, the get well soon. And oh, I hope you, I hope you get better. Or just, quick healings, and it's just, quick recovery. And it's just like, I'm not recovering. This is it. You can't scream that at people, but, it kind of makes me laugh at times how I get just over the top with it. But, I'm still trying to get, I posted something with Benalista. I was having my Benalista infusion that Friday before the 4th of July. And I posted a video about lupus not caring that it's a 3-day weekend. And I'm hooked up to the IV machine, getting my monthly infusion. And, you can see the comments from the lupus warriors. They're just like, girl, that Benalista hangover. And we're, I don't want to say making light of it, but we're sharing our experiences. And then you have the outside world, that it's, the prayer hands and the, speedy recovery. Then I'm getting the text messages, or sis, are you okay? Are you in the hospital? Do I need to come see you? And it's like, guys, I do this every month. And it's my life now. It's normal. This is it. I don't know how to explain that to people.
I think you just used a good word. It's like, it's our new normal. Like, we become used to it over time. We may not, obviously we don't enjoy it. It's frustrating. Mm-hmm. It brings a lot of challenges. But over time, it's like, okay, this is now a pattern. And we sort of mentally get ourselves like, okay, it's time to go for our infusions. To other people, it's like, wait, what are you doing? And you have to do this more than once. Like, how come it doesn't, cure you as soon as you get it? And there's a lot of questions there, right? I always felt like my family is like very, very Italian, very loud, a lot of sarcasm. I feel like humor has definitely helped in some ways, because it just helps me make light of some things that are really heavy, mm-hmm. And chronic illness, I feel like, is traumatic, can bring a lot of trauma into your life. And humor is one way that has helped, and counseling. I'm curious, since you're on stage, right, and everyone is, their eyes are on you, what is it like with that stigma of, look at you. You're a beautiful woman. You don't look sick, like they mm-hmm. like to describe us. Do you feel like people have a hard time when they see you on stage doing your thing, and you're so full of energy and you're hilarious and you look fine?
I think the person, and this is, I'm going to get very vulnerable here. I think the person that has the hardest time understanding that is my husband. And because he will see me, at one point he said to me, when I talk about just the pain and the dealing with the day-to-day, or sometimes we're so accustomed to being in pain at times where chances are we're not going to say anything about it unless it's like some kind of new pain, or the pain is at a level higher than we're accustomed to dealing with. And that's kind of how I am. It has to be something that's outside of our normal. Mm-hmm. And he's made comments about just, I don't look sick and I'm still going out and doing the thing that I'm doing. And I had to remind him that, there are times that I go on stage there. I have videos of me performing when I had really bad pleurisy. And you can, if you're listening really hard, you can hear the, with me delivering jokes, and I'm also very in tune with how I deliver certain material. So I can hear me trying to catch my breath, or mm-hmm. trying to make sure I don't get too out, too excited about something I'm saying, because I'm not going to be able to maintain what I'm trying to maintain. So I feel like it's more my family and the people that are closest to me that don't get that, because they'll see me come home and crash, but mm-hmm. they also see me collect myself and get on stage. And I had to explain to him that even during the worst days, I love comedy so much that that 20 minutes that I get to be on stage, I get to lose myself for that 20 minutes. I get to forget that I'm in pain. I forget to that I have a, you know, a disease. Being around other comics and we're, you know, just talking about whatever, I get to just be so involved and so immersed in that world that I can just remove myself from lupus for that short period of time. And that's why I do it. So yeah, it might be physically painful and physically demanding for me to leave the apartment, put on my clothes, first of all, to leave the apartment, to walk to the train. You're from New York. You know how exhausting it is just to get around New York, to walk up the subway steps or walk down the subway steps, to deal with all the strangers, to hopefully find the seat, because again, we don't present sick. So no one's just hopping up, you know, to give you a seat because you have lupus on the, you know, on the train. I've actually had somebody ask me to get up to give them a seat. And I'm very big on advocacy. I was like, nah, you know, you ask that guy over there. He looks healthy. I'll put on somebody else, but I'm not, you know what I mean? So it's people closest to me sometimes don't get that. But for me, getting on stage and just being able to forget just that for those few minutes, it makes all the difference. And I encourage anybody with a chronic illness to find that thing that they can do where they can just completely lose themselves, even if it's just for 20 minutes at a time. So yeah.
I agree. I think it's really important. Like I know when I'm painting and I'm listening to music, like my pain levels decrease. I get this rush, and I'm sure you get it also on stage. You know, when you find that thing and you're doing something that you love, like we have lupus, but we still have goals. We still have dreams. There's still things that we want to accomplish, you know, and it may look different. It may take us longer. We may push ourselves a little bit. And we know that once we do that, we're going to have to take a step back and rest. And it's just sort of like this give and take, but we still want to do it. And we still want to say like, you know, I did it. I went out there. I achieved it. I made this, whatever it is.
Yeah.
I think something that we talk about a lot here on Tilly and just, you know, even on Lupus Chick over the years, I think people when they're first diagnosed, maybe it's our hope that our friends and our family will be the ones that we get the most support from, but that's not always the case. It's sometimes the stranger that we meet online, you know, on a chronic illness page that we really connect with and we wind up becoming good friends with. It might be someone in our community. It's not, unfortunately, it isn't always our family, because I think sometimes it's maybe hard for them to understand why we're not the person we were years ago, you know, and what they were used to us being like or acting like, or how much energy we had, that something's changed. So I think that was really important point that you made there. And also the outside, the what we look like, I feel like it's a very fine line that we have to straddle every day. So you have to be, you have to look sick enough that the doctors or the ER medical personnel will take you seriously that you actually are sick, but you want to still look healthy enough because we live in a society where everything is judged on what you look like, right? And if you look really sick, people are going to have something to say about that because it's like, well, you're not trying, or, you know, you look disheveled, or what's wrong with you? And it's like this constant back and forth. And it's like, I'm so exhausted. I'm just trying to keep myself alive, right? Like, I don't have time for this. So, and you're in the public eye, like when you're on stage, obviously it's sort of like just something else added to the mix. So I'm always curious what the audience reacts like. Did you ever have someone come up to you afterwards and say like, I have lupus, or I just got diagnosed, or, you know, what is it? Because I haven't been feeling well. Is there sort of like a level of advocacy that you do when you're off stage?
So two things, going back to what you said, as far as looking, having to make sure you maintain yourself. You know, when I first found you, one of the things I noticed the most about you, I was like, oh my God, she's gorgeous. And it just, and I, she's gorgeous. I've struggled with my weight prior to lupus, and then I got a handle on it with Weight Watchers. And then I had, at one point, I had a doctor put me on 60 milligrams of prednisone, and I feel like I'm now coming back from that. And this was years ago. And I remember looking back at those pictures where I had that moon face. And it's funny how we do this to ourselves, because I remember seeing you and just being like, oh my God, she's so beautiful. She's so tiny. How does she maintain her weight with lupus? Does she exercise? I had all these questions. And it's interesting because I know better. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? I know all the things. I consider myself intelligent. I consider myself self-aware. You know, but still, it's just that looking at somebody else that has the same condition as you and wondering, well, how come she can maintain her weight and I'm struggling here with this prednisone? On the flip side too, when I used to lead Weight Watchers meetings, I was still leading them after being diagnosed. And I had a member come to me after a meeting, and I hadn't shared that I had lupus. She came to me after a meeting and she was saying that she's having a hard time losing weight and how she has lupus. And me thinking I was bonding with her, I didn't say I understand, because I also understand that lupus presents itself differently in everybody. And there are people that I know that are going through rougher patches than I am at the moment, and vice versa. Everybody has their cyclical moments. And I said to her, I was like, I also have lupus. And she goes, well, your lupus doesn't look like mine. You don't have it as bad as I do. And she immediately, and it was the way she said it, you can just feel the anger and the hurt and the, I'm not going to say it was malice, because I don't think it was, the malice was directed toward me, but just a frustration. And anybody who's ever tried to lose weight and tried multiple times, you can understand that frustration. Regarding getting off the stage, I've had people come up to me afterwards and thank me for saying, you know, bringing it up or just even mentioning it. And I feel like if you're in an audience and you hear lupus and you have lupus, it's like your ears perk up and you're like, you're now even more invested in listening to what this person has to say. And I know I feel that way. And if I'm watching TV, I was just watching on Virgin River on Netflix. Yes. And I posted about it on our Hydroxychloroquine's page. Somebody on the show was diagnosed with lupus, and the makeup artist went as far as to give them the butterfly rash. And it was just nice hearing them talk about it. And I said, whoever wrote this part, whatever writer was doing this, they either know someone with lupus, they have lupus themselves, because it was handled in such a beautiful way. They told us what lupus was. They said there was no cure. They say that it's treatable. This person can live a healthy life. And they talked about the monetary aspects that come with lupus, medication, how your life is going to change. I just thought they did it in such a beautiful way. So that's something that I aim to do a lot more when I'm online, because I feel like I can reach a larger audience. And when I talk about it online, the people that it's meant to reach and that are meant to hear it are going to find it and hear it easier than if I'm, say, at a comedy club where people are half drunk and they're probably more inclined to want to hear about not lupus. Yeah. So, but yeah, I do a lot more advocacy for lupus with comedy online, just because I feel like it's just easier to find, for people to find.
Yeah. I did actually see, I just started the next season of Virgin River, and I saw the video on your page, and it was very well done. And when they started talking about how expensive it is for a lupus patient every year, I was like, oh, wow, they really like went into all the detail, which I don't know if there's ever been a show, like a real, you know, network popular show like Virgin mm-hmm. River that has gone that deep into just what lupus is. So I agree with you on that.
Actually, All American, they didn't go that deep, but All American, I think that's on the CW, but I watch it on Netflix as well. One of the main characters, a girl that he was dating, she disappeared for months. And when she came back, it turned out that she was in a lupus flare. And how he found out is they were doing some kind of lupus lupus.org fundraiser on the show. So I was like, oh, people are talking. And this is, so that was, and there was another show. I forgot the other show, but the mom had lupus as well. So
we're getting there. Yeah, we're getting there. Slowly, a little bit at a time.
Yes.
So, well, I'm so glad that we got to know you more, and I got to know you more besides, you know, when we talk online. But yeah. If someone is near New York City, or like, do you travel? Like, where can someone come and see you perform?
So if you're in New York City, I'm very regularly at New York Comedy Club. There are two locations in New York City proper. I'm also usually at West Side Comedy Club as well, so you can find me there. And you can also check me on Instagram at A Dookie. That's A D as in David, O-O-K-I-E. Dookie really is my last name. Or you can find me on Facebook. And I literally think I'm the only Ayana Dookie in the world. So if you find me, that's me. So yeah, you can find me on Instagram, you can find me on Facebook. I usually post in my stories where I'm going to be. And yeah, drop me a note too. Thanks.
Yeah. And the hydroxychloroquine is a separate page, correct?
Yes. Okay. Yes. So if you come to my page, there's a link to our podcast. Like I said, me and Chanel Gabriel hosted, and, feel free to visit the podcast. We're always asking if there's a topic you want us to talk about, let us know. And if it's something that we don't have any expertise in, like someone asked us to talk about lupus and pregnancy, neither of us have been pregnant, we will find somebody to bring onto the podcast to talk about that. So yeah, definitely check out the podcast and our page as well.
I love that. Well, Ayana, thank you so much for being here. It was a great, great episode, and you're very bubbly and you're fun. And I just love when I need like that lift, I just go to your page. So thank you for that. Thank you for bringing some humor and laughter into something that can be really scary and very isolating, make you feel like you're alone.
Yes.
So thank you for that.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, absolutely. So definitely go and follow Ayana and come back next Tuesday night. We will be here with a new guest. And if you have never checked out Tilly before, feel free to go back into our video library. We've had so many incredible people on here. I'm so thankful for all of you. And I hope you all have a great week. Take care. Bye.